ugly cats, boat shoes, and overpriced jewelry. Pricing. Ugly cats, boat shoes, and overpriced jewelry. The sheer illogic of pricing. A Denver woman needed to sell four reasonably cute cats. She placed this classified ad in the Denver Post. Ugly cats, $100 each. 5555555. More than 80 people called. She said she could have sold the cats for far more. Timberland was struggling in the early 1980s. The company made a good boat type shoe and priced it below the leader, Top Sitters. A great product for the pricey hill, but not a good business. Then Timberland did something fairly simple. It increased its price to be well above Top Sitters. Sales boomed just as they boomed for American Express when it took over the prestige niche in credit cards by pricing its card just $1 more than a Diners Club card. In Influence, Robert Cialdini tells about the frustrated owner of a Native American jewelry store in Arizona. The owner had not been able to sell some turquoise jewelry, even though it was peak tourist season. She tried sales. Nothing. She tried sales training. She encouraged her staff to push the jewelry. Nothing. Finally, the night before she was leaving for a trip, the owner left her head saleswoman a note. Everything in this display case, price $1.50. The owner returned a few days later and learned that everything had sold, but not for the reason she thought. The saleswoman had misread the owner's scribbled note to read price $1.50, and doubled the price of everything. Some people think pricing is one of the more logical acts of marketing. These examples say something different. Don't assume that logical pricing is smart pricing. Maybe your price, which makes you look like a good value, actually makes you look second-rate. Pricing, the resistance principle. Just months into business, I have made my first great discovery about business, a young woman recently told me. There's one simple way to get all the business you can handle: charge almost nothing. She's right. If no one complains about your price, it's too low. If almost everyone complains, it's too high. So if no price resistance is too low and 100% is too high, how much resistance is just right? How much resistance tells you that your price is right? 15 to 20%. And there is one simple reason why: close to 10% of people will complain about any price. Some want a deal. Others are mistrustful and assume every price is overstated. Still others want to get the price they had in their mind when they approached you, because it's the price they hoped for and already have budgeted in their mind. So throw out the group that will object no matter what your price, then ask, in the remaining cases, how often do I encounter resistance? Resistance in 10% of those remaining cases, for a total of almost 20%, is about right. When it starts exceeding 25%, scale back. Setting your price is like setting a screw. A little resistance is a good sign. Avoiding the deadly middle. Companies and many services essentially set their rates by studying the going, high, and low rates, and then deciding where they fall on the quality spectrum. This unfortunate practice tells their customers exactly how good the company really thinks it is. Ask yourself, if that's how you are pricing your services, what are you saying to your customers and prospects that you aren't that great? Another problem with this pricing strategy is the problem of the deadly middle. If you are the high-priced provider, most people assume you offer the best quality at a desirable position. If you are the low-cost provider, most people assume you deliver an acceptable product at the lowest cost at also a desirable position. But if you price in the middle, what you are saying again is, we're not the best, and neither is our price, but both our service and price are pretty good. Not a very compelling message. The premium service and the low-cost provider occupy nice niches all by themselves. If you are priced in between, however, you are competing with almost everyone, and that's a lot of everyone's. Beware of the deadly middle, the low-cost trap. You can make a good marketing case for becoming the low-cost provider. Your position is clear and so is your price. It's the lowest a prospect can find. But the low-cost position kills. Where are they now? the great low-priced services of our past. The old synonyms for low-cost retailing are such as J.C. Penney, Montgomery Ward, and Sears are dead, dying, or reeling. At this writing, five discounters in the Northeast alone are suffering even more. Caldor and Bradley's have filed for bankruptcy. James Way is considering it, and Ames and Filene's are bleeding red ink. Low-cost providers take it from several directions. Cutting costs requires little imagination, and the low-cost position can be seized without a large investment in brand building. So in most non-retail service industries, the low-cost provider is a relatively easy market niche to enter. Just when you perfect your system for reducing costs, someone else devises a better one. As discount retailers discovered when Walmart jumped in, many low-cost providers attained their position through ruthless dealing with suppliers. Over the short term, that squeezing can work. Suppliers who need the business grudgingly oblige. But those suppliers never become allies. They even may generate bad word of mouth to compensate for the bad treatment they receive. If those suppliers get a good chance to get out of the deal years later, they do gleefully, bad word of mouth trailing them as they flee. Cost shavers also find it harder to inspire employees. Employees often see a company's intelligent austerity as mean-spirited cheapness. Would you like a windowless, carpetless cubicle 45 hours? But this is soft thinking, you say. Where's the hard data suggesting that low cost is a trap? In the Harvard Business Review, in its September-October 1980 issue, William Hill reported his study comparing companies that stress differentiation with companies that competed on cost. In every measure that mattered, in return on equity, return on capital, and average annual revenue growth rate, the differentiators beat the tightwads every time. Hull's study echoed what the people at ADP, the country's leader in payroll processing, have discovered. We will never try to develop a strategy based on pricing, CEO Josh Weston had said. There is nothing unique about pricing. Remember this, most service prospects can find an even lower cost option than yours. They can do the service themselves or not at all. The homeowner can paint his own house or postpone it indefinitely. The woman with a troublesome mole can diagnose her own ailment or refuse medical service altogether. The aggrieved subcontractor can take his own case to court or say to hell with it. People almost always can find a cheaper way to get your service, and few efforts are less rewarding than trying to compete with those cheaper ways. Beware of the rock bottom pricing. A lesson from Picasso. In many services, overnight delivery, dry cleaning, fast foods, the product of the service has become a commodity, and commodity pricing rules prevail. To the low-priced go the spoils. But in millions of other services, pricing is a not-so-simple matter of what will the market bear? A lot, it often seems. A friend marvels at his older brother, who earns $1 million a year, telling companies like Coca-Cola what the future might be. Lauren Stribe charges $750 an hour to read, think, and occasionally argue cases before the Supreme Court. Film directors, great photographers, top consultants, and many others charge enough to buy minutes. What is talent and thought worth, and why is some worth so much? What can you reasonably charge? Good questions. Before you answer them, consider this story about Pablo Picasso. A woman was strolling along a street in Paris when she spotted Picasso sketching at a sidewalk cafe tilde copyright. Not so thrilled that she could not be slightly presumptuous, the woman asked Picasso if he might sketch her, and charge accordingly. Picasso obliged. In just minutes, there she was, an original Picasso. And what do I owe you? She asked. 5,000 francs, he answered. But it only took you 3 minutes, she politely reminded him. No, Picasso said. It took me all my life. Don't charge by the hour, charge by the years. The carpenter corollary to the Picasso principle. A man was suffering a persistent problem with his house. The floor squeaked. No matter what he tried, nothing worked. Finally, He called a carpenter who friends said was a true craftsman. The craftsman walked into the room and heard the squeak. He set down his toolbox, pulled out a hammer and nail, and pounded the nail into the floor with 3 blows. The squeak was gone forever. The carpenter pulled out an invoice slip, on which he wrote the total of $45. Above that total were 2 line items, hammering, $2. Knowing where to hammer, $43. Charge for knowing where. Value is not a position. If your primary selling position is good value, you have no position. Value is not a competitive position. Value is what every service promises, implicitly or explicitly. It is fundamental to survival. A service's price must fairly reflect its value to the customer, or the service eventually will fail. Some legal services charge $50 for an uncontested divorce. Lawyer Lawrence Tribe charges $750 an hour. Acme's clients say they get good value, and most clients and experts point to Tribe's results at a 15-6 winning record before the U.S. Supreme Court, and they say he gives very good value, too. In services, value is a given, and givens are not viable competitive positions. If good value is the first thing you communicate, you won't be effective. If good value is your best position, improve your service. Monogram your shirts, not your company. Naming and branding. Monogram your shirts, not your company. ADPDMMETA ADCAPCABCCBCW. Which name above did you remember? None? Don't worry. Everyone flunks that memory test. It's because people cannot remember monograms. Monograms have no memorability. Just as bad, monograms have no spirit, no attitude, no message, no promise, no warmth, and no humanity. So why do so many companies use monograms? Blame IBM. IBM convinced executives that if they gave their company a fancy monogram like IBM, they would succeed like IBM. This is like thinking that Michael Jordan's shoes will make you like Mike. It's also like thinking that dinner causes midnight, because midnight always comes after dinner. Dinners don't cause midnight. And IBM's name didn't cause IBM's success. Give your service a name, not a monogram. Don't make me laugh. It's tempting to create a clever name. Sometimes, this temptation becomes so strong that you give your service a slightly funny name. Let's say, hair parent for a hair transplant clinic. Here's a test that will talk you out of this mistake. Look up one of those whittly named services. Chances are it's a hair salon or a pizza place. Go there and go in. You will notice 2 things. You have never been there before, and it's almost empty. Don't get funny with your name. To stand out, stand out. Kimberly Clark spends millions of dollars a year keeping people from calling. Tissues, Kleenexes. Xerox does the same to keep the word Xerox from becoming a synonym for photocopy. Why the fuss? Because these companies did not want their name to become generic. They want their name to stand for their product. Just as sophisticated marketers do not want their brand names to become generic, you do not want a generic name as your brand. A generic name is not your name, it is everyone's. 3 Twin Cities companies call themselves Financial Services Incorporated, Financial Specialist Incorporated, and Financial Counseling Incorporated. If someone from Financial Specialists called you, isn't there a great chance that months later you might think that call came from financial services? Do you want people not to know who you are? Not to remember you? Not to be impressed by you immediately? Not to be able to tell your company from half a dozen others? Generic names encourage generic business. Tell me something I don't know. Among advertising people, it is assumed that companies named creative something are not creative. That's partly because a name like Creative Design contradicts itself. The name, after all, could not be less creative. The same is true of quality, as in Quality Cleaners. Doesn't that sound like a cleaner that might break your buttons? Never choose a name that describes something that everyone expects from the service. The name will be generic, forgettable, and meaningless. Distinctive position, Distinctive name. What does the brain remember best? The authors of Brain Book answered this. They studied human memory and concluded that the mind best remembers things that are unique, sensory, creative, and outstanding. Advocates of distinctive names argue that distinctive names are more apt to be remembered, and being remembered often is the key to getting business. But another argument for distinctive names rests on a basic principle of successful marketing. Make yourself different. The human mind associates. When we hear ordinary names like John Jones, we draw an ordinary association. When we hear distinctive names like Faith Popcorn or Leaf Phoenix, we draw distinctive associations. An ordinary name implies just another service. A distinctive name implies a distinctive service and just the impression a service should make. In a world filled with Me Too company names, service companies with distinctive names like NameLab, Federal Express, and Prodigy quickly create the association that they are not Me Too services and profit from the association. Be distinctive and sound it. What's in a name? What if Lian Chen's restaurant was called Beijing? Would Lian Chen have made the cover of almost every magazine in Minnesota? Number. By naming her restaurant Lian Chen, she ensured that every mention of herself was an ad for her restaurant, and vice versa. By naming her restaurant after herself, Lian Chen made herself a celebrity. Her celebrity made the restaurant more popular, so she started a chain of restaurants. The restaurant's increasing popularity made her more of a celebrity, which made the restaurants even more popular, and on and on a not at all vicious circle. If you need a name for your service, start with your own. Names, the information Purinj test. Why do many Fortune 500 companies pay over $35,000 for a name? Because names make a company's first impression. First impressions count and often convey much of the little information about you that your prospects have. Given what a good name is worth, how do you measure a name's value? Put the name to this test. How much valuable information per inch does your name imply? A wonderfully named San Francisco company perfectly illustrates the information per inch principally, and given its business, it should. The company is NameLab, a company that specializes in naming products. With lightning speed, NameLab's name suggests the company takes a near scientific, analytic approach to developing names, something distinct in its industry. Beyond that, the freshness and slight whimsy of the name NameLab also suggests the company's capacity for creative, right-brain thinking. So NameLab conveys a powerful double meaning to its prospects, with an excellent information per inch ratio. Ask yourself, if you needed a good name for your service, whom would you call first? Names Incorporated, the name company, or NameLab? If you were a journalist writing a story on product or service names, which company would you call first? So far, every journalist's answer has been NameLab, as you may have noticed in dozens of publications. A week later, which company's name would you remember? And when that time came to name your company, which company would you probably call for help? Give every name you consider the information Purinj test. The cleverness of Federal Express, the master packer of naming, of the company that may have squeezed more good information into each inch of its NAMIA, is Federal Express. Express was not being widely used when Fred Smith chose Federal Express's name. Thanks to its usage in Pony Express and other places, Express connotes rapid mail delivery, faster than conventional mail. Now came the company's next question: what else should our name communicate? Nationwide, they agreed. Quickly, Smith probably considered the names National Express, Nationwide Express, and US Express are the obvious names that come quickly to mind. By contrast, Federal, a legalistic term for a political system of states with a central government, does not come quickly to mind. A great asset in a name. To give the name even more impact in the company's competition with government postal services, Federal also connotes an official government sanction or status. Smith admitted that he liked Federal because it sounded patriotic, although his main reason for fixing on Federal was that his initial business plan called for his company to deliver air freight for the Federal Reserve, So federal is a more distinctive, more memorable, and more authoritative way to convey nationwide. Now look at Federal Express in color. The colors again hint at the government sanctioned theme with their twist on red, white, and blue, but connote better quality by replacing the government's ordinary blue with a richer purple blue. So Federal Express conveys a distinctive and powerful message like the U.S. mail, only faster and better in just two words and two colors, a terrific information print ratio. Use Federal Express as your standard, and ask, how much does your name communicate? How fast are you using color effectively? Is it conveying the same message as your name? The brand rush. A revealing week in my life. Monday, a gifted lawyer calls. He quickly explains his problem. He is among the premier practitioners in his specialty, but he is losing business to inferior lawyers and two brand name law firms. He wants that hole plugged. Wednesday afternoon, the president of a contracting company calls. A heavily advertised competitor is charging far more for comparable jobs and still getting the bids, despite my caller's room full of industry trophies. Thursday morning, the president of a professional consulting firm calls. Her firm has grown incrementally by word of mouth, and cannot penetrate the more lucrative, challenging, and prestigious accounts that would give the firm more stature. The big name firms own all those accounts. This was an actual week in my life in 1995, by years, and I was ready to dub it the year of the brand rush, or the year when thousands of service companies finally realized the enormous cloud of brands. Each caller was getting beaten by a brand. Each caller's company offered demonstrably excellent, even superior service, yet each was losing business to brands. Each company was growing, but more sluggishly than it deserved. But each executive had finally realized something critical. In service marketing, almost nothing beats a brand. Aren't brands dying? The business magazine headlines ask, are brands dead? You see several of those headlines over time and decide the rumors must be true. They aren't. Those who argue that brands are dying offer as exhibit 1 the rise of store-branded or generic products. Those observers are overlooking something. Generic products are not truly non-branded. In a reputable store, the generic product carries a distinctive promise. The promise of the store. The store promises that the product will perform and that the store will back it. The generic product, in short, carries the store's brand. Clearly, store-branded products have brands of service brands rather than product brands, but still brands. To the customer, the fact that the store is convenient and one with which the customer probably has dealt for years gives that store brand special power. But just for argument, assume that generic and store-labeled products are not brands. Then what? At this writing, store and generic brands own 7% of the market, name brands own the remaining 93%. Considering the much lower cost of generics and store brands, the heavy publicity about the high quality of many store brands, and the number of savvy consumers who realize that many store brands are simply name brands in store packaging, the fact that these store and generic brands still own only 7% of the market seems amazing until you recognize the enormous power of a brand. Name national brands charge substantially more, up to 40% more, for products that often only equal store products in quality. Yet name national brands still represent 13 of every 14 sales in the market. Amazing, and perhaps the best evidence of the enormous power of brands. Brands are alive, and you could use one. The warranty of a brand. What is a brand? A brand is more than a symbol. In the public's eye, a brand is a warranty. It is a promise that the service carrying that brand will live up to its name and perform. A brand is even more important than a warranty. No warranty does enough, because no warranty compensates the warranty holder for the lost time, the frustration, and the inconvenience of suffering the problem and making the claim. The brand, then, becomes even more important because it is the closest thing to a guarantee that the customer will not need the warranty and have to endure the claims process. Brands are even more important to service customers, because few services have warranty ESSA, in part because many services are very difficult to warrant. How do you warrant, for example, that legal advice will be good, that a waiter's service will be satisfactory, that a tax accountant will find every permissible deduction? In many cases, you cannot. Left without a warranty, the client has only the brand on which to depend. And depending on brands is just what service clients do. A service is a promise, and building a brand builds your promise. The heart of a brand. When a prospect initially agrees to use a typical service, what does he own? Nothing but someone's promise that they will do something. The most desirable services, then, are those that keep their promises. This also means that the heart of a service brand, the element without which the brand cannot live, is the integrity of the company and its employees. The value of any brand rises or falls with each demonstration of the company's integrity. The balance is fragile. Every slip can be costly. We all have worked with services that failed us only once, but fatally. They lied or came close. From that one experience, their brand lost all its value to us. When others later asked us about that company, we may have said very little, but our message was clearer and it spread. A service can be faster, cheaper, better, and still fail if it does not win the confidence of people that it will keep its promises and tell the truth. The heart of a service brand is not artful packaging, slick advertising, or the company name emblazoned on everything from sweatshirts to keychains. The heart of a service brand, and a key to a service's long-term success, is the integrity of the people behind it. Invest in and religiously preach integrity. It is the heart of your brand. What brands do for sales? A brand will have three dramatic effects on your selling. First, consider a common occurrence. Someone hears a positive story about a non-branded company. They remember the story but naturally forget the company's name, so they cannot pass the story on. When the same person hears a story about a brand name service, he remembers the story and the company, so he can pass the story along and does. Word of mouth for a branded service spreads easier and farther, producing more inquiries. Second, a brand single-handedly converts more of these inquiries into clients. Prospects feel more comfortably and less fearful with a brand name. No one ever got fired for choosing IBM, the old saw goes. It applies to choosing brand name services, too. For the same amount of selling effort, a branded service makes more sales than a non-branded service. Third, consider the plight of the typical non-branded service. To justify her choice of a non-branded service, a prospective client often must schedule follow-up presentations with the key people in her company, or her spouse. If it is a consumer service, frequently, a non-branded service will spend more on this lengthy selling process than the initial project is worth. Branded services rarely face that expense. In fact, prospects routinely choose brand name services virtually sight unseen, so brands take less time and expense to sell. Brand name services can spend less time and money to get more business. This gives them greater profits to reinvest to make their company even more productive and widen the gulf between them and their non-branded competitors. Make selling easier, faster, and cheaper. Build a brand. Stand by your brand. It is the tale of the wild world of advertising, perhaps, but the moral often is missed. A hot ad agency emerges. It wins dozens of awards and the adoration of a hungry trade press looking for the newest thing. Eventually, the hot agency wins a big account. If it is good and lucky, the agency keeps that account and wins even more. It becomes a brand. Almost everyone is happy. Everyone except George, Ed, Mary, and Nancy, the team who did all the work for which their agency is taking credit. Flush with confidence, the foursome meet secretly and make a decision. They will haul their Clios, their clippings, and their prodigious talent to a neat loft downtown and build their own hot agency. Remember that George, Ed, Mary, and Nancy comprise the entire team of the account person, media planner, writer, and art director Ura, who created those fabulous commercials that made the Hot Agency hot. They are the people that Coca-Cola trusted with $60 million. Does this tale end with our four heroes living happily ever after? Sadly, number. Their new agency gets a nice assignment here and there, but for years, they struggle with tight budgets, fewer clippings, and a growing sense that something is missing. What has happened? George, Ed, Mary, and Nancy still have the talent and experience here, but they no longer have the brand. All they have lost is their brand, but the loss is enormous. The four struggle on, thinking that prospective clients will see through the sheer folly of this brand thing and recognize that Jim and are really their old brand agency under a new roof and with much lower overhead to boot. And then one Friday, George locks Jim Inn's doors behind him for the last time. Jim Inn were not beaten by bad planning, the sudden disappearance of their muses, or a U-turn in the economy. They were beaten by a brand of the one they lost and never regained. Never underestimate the value of your brand or the difficulty in creating a new one. The 400 grand brand. Here's a true story, with the names changed to protect the innocent and the fortunate. Two men, Phil and Don, spent 7 years building a contracting company into a solid business. They aren't famous, but they do well enough to order filet mignons without thinking twice. In 1995, another man approached them and offered $400,000 for their business. Phil and Don's contracting company had no inventory, no proprietary products or services, no patents or copyrights, and only one employee other than Phil and Don. The company rented a storefront and owned no real estate, no capital assets, and no accounts receivable. A thorough accounting, in fact, would have revealed that the $400,000 company's only assets were its name and client list. What was the buyer offering to buy? Was it the client list? It couldn't be. Clients used the company's service only once or twice in a lifetime. Repeat business wasn't much better than in funeral parlors. Moreover, the client list had value only if the clients thought that although the old owners were no longer with the company would still provide the same high quality. In other words, those old clients and any new owners were simply buying the brand. And that is what the businessman offered $400,000 for. 2. A $400,000 brand, built in just 7 years with relatively little investment. For years, Amra, a Dallas-based provider of vinyl siding, paid Sears $30 million each year, more than 7 times Amra's net profit, to license Sears's brand name. As a result, and because of the consumer's confidence in the Sears name, Amra was able to mark up each siding sale 2.2 times FR over industry norms. In 1995, Amra realized there was a good brand with a much lower price and struck a 20-year, $230 million licensing agreement with Century 21. Kraft sold for 8 times its book value. Experts agreed that the only explanation was the enduring power and enormous value of the Kraft brand. What is a brand worth? Should you try to build one? Thousands, millions, then billions. And emphatically, yes, a brand is money. Brands in a microwave world. You want a new sound system, because you love music and hate wasting money on large purchases. You want to choose wisely, but you also have 8 calls to return, a lawn to mow, 1 recital, and 3 little league practices. You are, in short, the typical got-no-time American. You cannot buy more time, so you must give some up. You need shortcuts. You need some way to speed your decision on that sound system. Fortunately, you find your shortcut, a brand name system. Brands are decision-making shortcuts in a world of people like you looking for shortcuts. Often, a brand is all the information some people will need to choose their next sound system, even though at least one unbranded system is clearly superior and 30% cheaper than the system they choose. In choosing a brand name sound system, you demonstrate a rule of modern marketing: as time shrinks, the importance of brands increases, and time in America is shrinking. Companies have downsized their staffs and upsized the workloads of all the survivors. These people need shortcuts every waking minute. They turn to service and product brands. Give your prospects a shortcut. Give them a brand. Brands and the power of the unusual. Try this test. The following are most of the great brand names of the English-speaking world. A few brands have been overlooked, although being overlooked says something about that brand. Harley Davidson, Sony, Honda, Procter Gamble, Nike, Levi Strauss, Rolls Royce, Disney, Xerox, Kleenex, Coca-Cola, Mercedes-Benz, Lloyds of London, Nikon, Harvard, Kodak, Microsoft, Marlboro. What is striking about this list? It is how unusual these names are. Virtually no one or nothing else carries any of these names. You know no other Sony, Disney, Harvard, Kodak, or Harley. Unless you studied mythology and recognize the goddess Nike, or studied anthropology and remember Claude L.A. Tilde copyright Levi Strauss, you have no other connotations for Nike and Levi Strauss. Either. Consider the brand names in the following services, and ask yourself, where else have you heard these names? Accounting, Ernst Young, Deloitte Touche, Cooper's Librand, Piet Marowijk, Law, Skadden Arps, Covington Burling, Fulbright Jaworski, Pillsbury, Madison Sutro. Consulting and consultants, McKinsey, Bain, Sinch, Hamill, Prelid, Drucker. Business schools, Wharton, Tuck, Fuqua, Harvard, Stanford. Granted, in each of these four service categories you find one usual name: Arthur Anderson in accounting, Sullivan Cromwell in law, Tom Peters in consulting, and Kellogg in business schools. Although giving a business school the name of a successful and well-regarded business sounds like smart marketing, even if the name is not unusual. But each of these exceptions seems to prove the rule. Most of the great brand names are unconfusable. People associate those brand names only with the companies behind them. The names have no bad associations created by their connection to something else with the same name. We follow this principle when we name our children. We ruthlessly exclude every name with any negative association. So after Nixon and Watergate, Americans stopped naming boys Richard, just as parents everywhere stopped naming children Adolf after World War II. People's minds are quick to make connotations. The smart service company avoids any rub-off of negative connotations by developing unconfusable brand names. To speed up the building of your brand, choose an unconfusable name. Brands and the babysitter. Brands are for the rich, you say. Not so as the story of the babysitter shows. Kate Thurman is the feature president of a very successful company, but today, she is a high school freshman, a babysitter, and a born marketer. Kate seeks out every neighborhood place that parents frequent: the toy store, Gymboree storefront, daycare centers, and school summer camps. She convinces proprietors they are serving parents by posting Kate's signs for her service, Kate ATM Young Kids. Borrowing the idea from local remodelers, Kate also creates a red, blue, and white sign, Kate ATM Young Kids, a world-class babysitting, 5551111, and mounts it on her old red and white rocking horse. On the lawn of every house where she sits, Kate plants the rocking horse. Kate's uncle Frank owns the neighborhood video star via another marketing opportunity. Kate convinces Frank to let her place her red, white, and blue ad in the clear sleeves on the back of each video jacket. Kate pays for this with three free nights of babysitting for Frank's baby girl, whom Kate adores and would happily watch for free. Kate then becomes a babysitter temp agency. She lines up other girls to work in return for 10% of their pay. Local parents know they will always get a sitter through Kate, so they are willing to pay Kate a 15% premium for eliminating their hassle of finding sitters, especially at the last minute. So Kate's employees make more per hour through Kate than they would earn on their own. Naturally, Savvy local sitters start going through Kate. Kate has created a dynasty. Everyone in her 10 square mile neighborhood recognizes her name. When parents from other neighborhoods ask Sheridan residents about sitters, they say, "Call Kate." And those parents do. The local press soon hears about the young entrepreneur and writes a story. A reporter for the local CBS affiliate reads a story, calls Kate, and does a 3-minute feature on WeTM Young Kids on the 6 o'clock news. Kate charms and impresses everyone listening at all 170,000 people. In the entire market that she serves, Kate has built a booming brand. For about $32 in paint and plywood, building your brand doesn't take millions. It takes imagination. How to save $500,000. Communicating and selling. Communicating, a preface. Because services are intangible, marketing communications for services do more than promote services. Communications make services more tangible, and give prospects something from to evaluate. As a result, marketing communications for most services haul around a heavier burden than communications for products. A bright red Porsche 911 convertible, for example, speaks loudly and beautifully for itself. Very few services speak for themselves at all. We implicitly trust most products. We trust that our new tires won't blow out, our brown sugar will taste sweet, and our aspirin will soothe our headaches without bad side effects. But we are far less trusting and certain about most services. We worry that our lawyers and auto mechanics will do more than necessary, and charge more than necessary. We worry that the latest weight loss service will fail, just like the three before it. We worry that our remodelers will exceed their budget and finish weeks after they promise. We worry that the collection agency we hire for our service will harass our clients worth keeping and collect only a small part of our outstanding receivables. So unlike communicating about products, communicating about services must make the service more tangible and real, and must soothe the worried prospect. It's not like selling Porsche automobiles. The first two rules of communicating about services: make the service visible, and make the prospect comfortable. Fran Lebowitz and your greatest competitor. It's not a cold, hard world, it's just a very busy one. You know it firsthand. A dozen things compete for your attention, and you have only so much attention to give. So you must know that your prospects have only so much attention to give, too. Give them powerful reasons to listen to you, or they will give you only ear service. They may listen, but they will not hear. Your greatest competition is not your competition. It is indifference. Many service marketers know this, but few act on it. Instead of talking about the prospect and what she needs, these marketers talk about their company. Instead of showing what they will do for a prospect, they strive to show how good their company is. Instead of speaking the prospect's language, they speak their own. The prospect is thinking, "Me, me, me." Unfortunately, the marketer is thinking that, too. The two fail to connect. Few people are particularly interested in what you have to say. As Fran Lebowitz once said of people who wore sweatshirts with messages, "People don't want to hear from you, so what makes you think they want to hear from your shirt?" People are interested in themselves. Until you realize that, you will be beaten badly by your toughest competitor, indifference. Your first competitor is indifference, the cocktail party phenomenon. Psychologists call it the cocktail party phenomenon. Psychologists, it appears, have learned the value of memorable packaging, too. You've experienced the cocktail party phenomenon. It works like this. You're listening to someone at a cocktail party. Suddenly, you hear your name mentioned in a nearby conversation. Now you can hear that conversation, but you no longer can hear the one in which you were involved. This happens because people cannot process two conversations at once. If you deliver two messages, most people will process just one of them, if that. Say one thing. The grocery list problem. Actually, the challenge of getting your message across is greater than the cocktail party phenomenon might suggest. Consider this. Mom sends you to the store for milk. You bring home the milk. Next time, she says, "Get raisins, Jano. gummy bears, milk, and some 100-watt light bulbs. You forget the milk, but it's the milk your family needed most. All you have for breakfast tomorrow is cereal. You run this risk when you hand prospects a grocery list of different messages about you. They remember the raisins, which aren't important, and forget the milk. Your prospects forget your real point of distinction, and remember a supporting message that hardly matters. Now, consider some even grimmer evidence against communicating too much. Horace Schwerin and Henry Newell, in their helpful book Persuasion, describe their test of two commercials for the same car. Commercial 1 was single-minded. It talked only about performance. Commercial 2 went further. It pointed out that in addition to exceptional performance, the car offered outstanding styling, a choice of several models, and excellent economy. This type of commercial is known in the agency business as the commercial the client will love. After showing subjects the two commercials, the testers asked viewers if either commercial might make them switch to that brand of car. 6% answered yes, the performance spot would make them consider switching. But what about the second commercial? With all that valuable added information, how many were affected by it? Not one. 0%. Saying many things usually communicates nothing. Give me one good reason. You want the strongest argument for a single focused message? Ask your prospects. Your prospects have one basic question: what makes you so different that I should do business with you? Your prospects are making the classic statement: give me one good reason why. It's a simple request that begs for a simple response. A complex response will just give your prospect another problem to sort out. Your prospect does not want more to think about. Your prospect wants less. An example from retailing shows the importance of a simple message. Go to a good men's store like Barney's in New York. Ask for a blue striped Oxford shirt. A savvy salesman will show you one nice shirt, which you probably will buy. But if he isn't that smart and shows you three shirts, there is an excellent chance you won't buy any shirt. The salesperson has complicated your decision and confused you with choices, and it is very hard to sell to a confused person. Meet your market's very first need. Give it one good reason. Your favorite songs. Driving down the freeway, you switch on your favorite radio station and hear a song for the first time. You like it but do not remember it. The next afternoon you hear the song again. Perhaps you note the singer, and perhaps you remember her name. Two mornings later, you hear the song again. After making sure no other commuters are watching, you start singing along with the hook, which you now remember. 2 days later you buy the CD. You play it several evenings. By the third evening, you know most of the words. It has taken 7 or 8 playings for the song's message to sink in. But finally, it has. What if the singer changed the song and tune every time? What would you remember? Almost nothing. What does this tell you about your marketing communications? Can you keep changing your words, your melody, your entire theme? If you do, what will people remember? For what will they know you? After you say one thing, repeat it again and again. One story beats a dozen adjectives. Pick up a good magazine and glance at a few stories. You may spot a pattern that tells you something. Today, most nonfiction writers begin their articles with an illustrative story. It's a device so pervasive there is a name for it: synecdoche. Trial lawyer Jerry Spence almost always makes a point with a story. Spence knows that for all the enormous changes in Western culture since the Greeks, today, almost 2,500 years after Euripides, our primary form of entertainment is still the dramatic narrative via the story. More marketers should discover the power of stories. Just as stories make articles more interesting and make Spence's arguments more persuasive, they make marketing communications more effective. Synecdoche works because people are interested in other people, and stories are about people. Jerry Spence's story of a person wronged by excessive police force does not need the words pain and injustice. His vivid story makes jurors feel the pain and injustice. Like clever journalists and great lawyers, marketers who tell true stories make their presentations more interesting, more personal, more credible, and more felt and more persuasive. Don't use adjectives, use stories. Attack the stereotype. Almost every well-known service suffers from a well-known stereotype. Accountants are humorless. Lawyers are greedy. Collections agencies are bullies. Doctors keep you waiting. The stereotype of your service is the first thing that a prospect thinks about. It is the first hurdle you must jump, and the first one over usually wins. Attack your first weakness, the stereotype the prospect has about you. Don't say it, prove it. Carolyn Adams, then circulation director of the Unreader, once sent me the magazine's subscription solicitation letters for the past 10 years. She said they never had written a letter that could outperform the first one, written by a famous copywriter. The first letter was the best example of good, readable writing. It was specific, not general. It was concrete, not abstract. It used vivid and familiar examples to make its points. The last sentence of each paragraph enticed you to read the first sentence of the next. The writer never used two words when one would do. The difference in this letter wasn't direct marketing gimmicks and tricks. It wasn't the teaser headline on the envelope. It didn't have one. It wasn't the shrewd use of the PS. It didn't have one of those, either. This letter was just good communication. It never said that the Unreader was great. It skipped all those adjectives and all the puffing, and proved it. This was a very interesting magazine and well worth the price. Good basic communicating is good basic marketing. Build your case. In the last 3 years, three of my clients have offered the best service in their entire industry. But do their prospects know it? Thousands of them didn't know, and puffery would never have convinced them. So two of the clients commissioned independent customer satisfaction surveys. The scores were astonishing. So they told their prospects. In one case, they told their prospects that the company had received the highest customer satisfaction scores an independent surveying firm had ever recorded. In the other, the company asked the respondents to score the client. The company then translated these customer satisfaction scores into grade point averages based on the traditional 4.0 scales. The company's service quality score was a fabulous 3.96. They built their case. Merely saying you offer great service will never work. You have to document and demonstrate it. Create the evidence of your service quality. Then communicate it. Tricks are for kids. A service is a promise. You're selling the promise that at some future date, you will do something. This means what you really are selling is your honesty. Tricks and gimmicks aren't honest. Gimmicky headlines, swimsuit models, direct marketing tricks, they're all a form of bait and switch. And these tricks say one thing. They tell your prospects you're willing to trick them, and that tells your prospects that you'll try to trick them again. Don't. No tricks. The joke's on you. A friend tells you a lame joke. You laugh, of course. It's human nature. You send someone what you think is a clever gimmick promotion, let's say, a plastic fish with a note inside, "Let's hook up, weary great catch," or something. Heaven help you, better. You call to ask your prospect if she received your promotion. She tells you yes, it was clever. Of course she tells you that it's human nature. She knows you were trying to be clever and that you were hoping for a compliment. So she gives you what sounds like one. A few more phone calls like that make you think that your clever little promotion is a good idea. Psychologists call this the false consensus effect. We imagine that people agree with us even though they do not, but the basic message of these use us, we're clever, it can make you look silly. It also can make it seem that because you have nothing important to say, you tell lame jokes instead. If you think your promotional idea might seem silly or unprofessional, it is. Being great versus being good. People in professional services are especially prone to thinking that the better they get, the better their business will be. The more the tax lawyer knows about the tax code, the actuary knows about qualified plans, and the psychologist knows about bipolar personality disorders, the more business will beat a path to their doors. Two examples suggest this simply is not true. and a third seems to prove it. The first is on display in every American courtroom today. Brilliant lawyers with a thorough grasp of the law drone on as judges watch the clocks and jurors nod. The lawyers are trying to sell their technical excellence, but their audience are the people who decide whether the lawyer will win or Lucia wants something else. The practice of medicine suggests a similar problem. In a remarkably short time, medical science has found cures for the plagues that killed millions of our ancestors: polio, tuberculosis, and smallpox. A woman with a fatally defective heart can now buy a new one. Psychiatrists can now medicate patients with severe disorders and make them far more functional than they could be 10 years ago. The medical industry clearly has become technically more competent and expert. The industry clearly has become much better at delivering the expert part of its service. And so the medical industry should be riding a wave of popularity. Yet 37% of people say doctors lack a genuine interest in their patients. Less than half believe that doctors explain things well to patients. Doctors believe that technical proficiency is the measure of their worth, but patients view the relationship side as so critical. There's even a name for it: bedside manner, that they think medicine is failing as a service. But the best evidence that superior performance is not critical to success in services probably comes from the financial markets. In the 1995 Goldman Sachs report, The Coming Evolution of the Money Management Industry, the firm confessed that the real business of money management is not skillfully managing money. It is gathering and retaining assets and marketing. To cut right to the point, is Goldman Sachs simply ignoring their clients' insistence on performance? Not at all. When asked to rank the most important criteria for choosing an investment firm, clients consistently put return on investment as the best evidence of technical proficiency in investing below trust and other relationship issues. In one survey, clients rated track record 9th out of 17 attributes, rating it below a sincere desire for a long-term relationship. Among other seemingly soft criteria, prospects do not buy how good you are at what you do. They buy how good you are at who you are. Superiority. David Ogilvy, who turned his genius for advertising into the famous Ogilvy Mather Agency and, later, a huge chateau in France, once observed that marketers are wrong to emphasize superiority. Ogilvy argued you can accomplish just as much by convincing a prospect that your service is positively good. You can test the validity of Ogilvy's observation with your own experience. How often are you really looking for the very best service, the very best babysitter, cleaning lady, or tax advisor? Not often. How often do you even know the best when you find it? Not often. How long are you willing to look to find the very best, when someone very good is readily available? Not long. How much more will you pay for the very best, especially if very good is good enough? Not much. How much do you trust other people's assessment of the very best? Not much. How good does anything have to be to satisfy you? Only very good. Anything better is a bonus. And a critical question: how do you respond when a service tells you it is the very best? Skeptically, and not very well. It sounds like bragging and puffing. People who conduct oral surveys for service clients quickly learn something surprising and disappointing to their clients. If the surveyor asks, "What is the main reason you continue to do business with this company?" the most common answer they hear, even from clients of superior services, is, "I just feel comfortable with them." Not superiority. Not even excellence. Just simple old leather slippers comfort. Our competitive culture fills us with the desire to be number one. It's exciting to be part of the best. Best does have its rewards. But the assumption that being the very best is a necessary marketing position, much less a uniquely powerful one, is refuted by experience. Your own. Convey that you are positively good. The cloud of reverse hype. A gutsy professional firm once demonstrated the weakness of hype by creating a truly unusual ad. Their little ad understated everything. They eliminated almost every adjective. Ad went unique along with its modest replacement, distinctive. They slashed exceptional, to accept the exceptional that referred to the quality of many competitive firms. And so it went. The resulting ad's impact wasn't even in the words of these professionals who despised hyperbole remarkable. For days, professional peers stopped the firm's members on the street to remark on the ad. Despite the firm's relatively tiny size, it received dozens of inquiries from prospective hires who before then had never heard of the firm. Executives from non-competing firms called the office manager to ask who had created the ad. Other executives contacted the creators to ask for an ad just like it as something everyone will notice and talk about. People notice marketing communications that refuse to strain the truth because people notice the unusual. And understatement is unusual. Far better to say too little than too much. The first bank's lesson: people hear what they see. A researcher once asked 20 business owners what several first bank's commercials were communicating and shocked the creators. These commercials featured an attorney preparing to climb Everest. His preparation included studying previous climbs, weather patterns, and other pertinent information. The bank's explicit message, intoned by the announcer, was that success in anything requires information, and that first banks had the information you need to make good financial decisions. But the people watching the commercial didn't hear the words. They saw the pictures, most of which showed the attorney practicing rock climbing. From those pictures, those people decided that first banks was saying it was strong and solid, like the man and mountain. Apparently a message totally unintended by the people who created the commercial. People hear what they see. A memorable 1980 ad for an interior decorator in Portland, Oregon, suggested it. The longer your office, says a struggling young attorney. The headline read, "The longer the struggle." People cannot see your service. So, as the ad reminds us, they judge your service by what they can see. If people see one thing while you are saying another, the first bank's example shows that seeing really is believing. People will trust their eyes far before they will ever trust your words. Look at your business card, your lobby, your shoes. What do your visibles say about the invisible thing you are trying to sell? Watch what you show. Make the invisible visible. We hear someone say, "He bought it sight unseen." They say "ita" and we hear "ita" with amazement. We cannot imagine someone buying something without seeing it first. Potential buyers are hesitant to consider things they cannot see, so they emphasize what they see and see. As a result, visual symbols of a service become important. Willie Loman, in Arthur Miller's Death of a Salesman, knew the importance of a shoe shine because he knew that people look for clues. Lawyers devote intense attention to having the right end tables, chairs, and lighting that will capture their essence. Most accountants dress carefully and conservatively by conscious design, to communicate that they are methodical and attentive to detail. Consciously or subconsciously, these people are performing an act of marketing. They are trying to make the invisible visible. Not surprisingly, the industry that best understands the importance of visualizing the invisible offers the least visible service of all: insurance. Prudential has its Rock of Gibraltar, Travelers its umbrella, Allstate its good hands, Transamerica its tower, Wausau its railroad station. Each uses a visual metaphor to describe the company. Many services, recognizing this principle and the principle that services are simply relationships among people, visualize their business with the person behind it. Charles Schwab, Henry Bullock, Colonel Sanders, Dave Thomas, Jewel Hyatt, and Wolfgang Puck. Ad agencies have constantly visualized their service through their people. Through Leo Burnett, David Ogilvy Mather, Jay Chiat Day, Bill Birnbach, Doyle Dane Birnbach, and Mary Wells, Rich Green. Consider, too, the leather portfolios that investment firms use to symbolize prosperity, the Doric columns that many law firms use to symbolize longevity, or the padded shoulders that the armed services use to symbolize strength. Prospects look for visual clues about a service. If they find none, They often look to services that do have them, so provide clues. Make sure people see who you are. The orange test. You go to a store looking for oranges. You sort through the batch, choose the richest, orangest ones and take them home. You have been fooled. There is no correlation between the orangeness of an orange and its flavor. Growers pick oranges when they are green, and at that moment, the oranges are as rich, ripe, and juicy as they will ever be. The rich orange color is actually the orange grower's trick. The growers take the green oranges into the plant and gas them with an ethylene compound, which breaks down the chlorophyll in the peel that makes the peel green. In states where it is still legal, growers also may dye the orange with red dye number 2. So the orangeness is not an assurance of flavor. It is the result of all the extra chemicals and labor that went into fooling us, and for which we pay extra every time we buy an orange. Yet even people who know this still pluck at the orangest oranges from the grocery stock. People who know better, people like me, still are fooled by the oranges package. This sounds very familiar, because every day in every city and town, this same act plays itself out when people choose a service. Not knowing what's really inside the service, people look to the outside. Unable to see the service, they choose it based solely on the things they can see it in many cases, even when they know better. Seeing is believing. So check your peel. Our eyes have it. The Lessons of Chicago's Restaurants. Richard Melman is the wizard behind Scoozie's, Ed Debovic's, and several of Chicago's other most popular restaurants. Many connoisseurs take Melman's success as another sign that image is everything, that in restaurants, looking good is better than cooking good. The critics miss the point. They assume that restaurants are in the food business. Not so, restaurants are in the entertainment business. People go to restaurants for the experience. They even go to famous restaurants with great cuisine, like the Mansion at Turtle Creek or 510 Grovelanta, to see what all the fuss is about, to experience what others have, to see who might be there, and to dress up. Melman's success, then, illustrates the wisdom of knowing what business you're really in, and selling what people are buying. But Melman's critics also ignore another factor in Melman's success that is important to any marketer. Few people have discriminating taste like the late James Beard, who could discern the entire recipe for a complex sauce from one sip. Instead, our perceptions of the quality of almost everything, from professional advice to veal scallopinia, are often unsophisticated. Because of this, our perceptions are very vulnerable to influence. When we try the roast duck at the Mansion at Turtle Creek, for example, it tastes good in large part because of the glowing reviews, the gorgeous atmosphere, and the stratospheric prices. Can most of us really taste the difference in the Mansion's roast duck? Not at all. Like good restaurateurs, service marketers must create the visual surroundings, so from the parking lot to the last page of the proposal, that will enhance the client's perception of quality. Offer quality without creating that perception of quality and you have failed the client, and yourself. Everything visual associated with your service sends a powerful clue about your service. The influence of these visual clues is not superficial. They go to the very heart of your product and your relationship with the client. Watch and perfect the visual clues you send. How to save $500,000. You can walk into several large local service companies and find almost $500,000 worth of sales brochures displayed on their walls. What you cannot do is tell where those brochures came from and what company stands behind them. No two look the same. No two reinforce a common message. Their inconsistency makes the company look inconsistent and disorganized. A whole set of negative associations follow from that. If you run Bob's Business Services, you want people to say, "Oh, that brochure is from Bob's Business Services." Words alone will not get that response, because our memories are primarily visual. We remember faces but forget names. So show a common face. Make that investment worthwhile. Repeat yourself visually, too. It makes you look more organized and professional, and easier to remember. The hearsay rule. Thanks to O.J. Simpson's trial of the century, Millions more people now know something about the hearsay rule. The hearsay rule puzzles many viewers and law students, but rests on a basic human principle. To evaluate what someone says, a person needs to see the speaker. The jurors must see the witness. They cannot just hear what the witness says. This principle of presenting a legal argument also applies to presenting the argument for a service. Prospects need to see you to decide about you. They want to see signals that convey who you are, even the subtlest signals. Your watch is it showy? Your shoes are the backs polished? 2. Your eyes, do they suggest you are not telling the whole truth? The prospect is being invited into a relationship, and wonder so with whom? Who are these people? This is what the prospect is asking, yet most service companies ignore the question. They institutionalize their company instead of personalizing it. The prospect wants to see flesh and blood. The company shows brick and mortar, a picture of the building and some symbols for the service. Or the company shows stock photos of paid models shaking hands or meeting to discuss an important issue in this company, where none of them work. Good salespeople know better. They know that if a prospect declines a face-to-face meeting but requests some information about your company, they rarely will make the sale. They know the prospect must see them to believe them, and buy. The salesperson knows this principle of selling a service, which is the principle behind the hearsay rule. People must see who is saying something to decide whether they will buy it. Give your marketing a human face. Metaphorically speaking, the black hole phenomenon. For years, physicists discussed an important phenomenon, the gravitationally completely collapsed object. Physicists knew these objects had profound implications. These objects could answer the question, how did the universe begin, and how might it end? For years, this discussion was just among leading physicists. Then some creative physicist devised a better name for a gravitationally completely collapsed object. He called it a black hole. Suddenly, the whole world was interested. People were intrigued by the concept of a hole in space, which itself already seemed like an enormous hole. The idea of something black in space, which already is black, this whole concept intrigued millions of people. Now people were talking. Sci-fi movies featured half-mad cowboy astronauts rushing suicidally into black holes. The words black hole changed how people thought. Most important, the words helped people get the idea of a gravitationally completely collapsed object. Your words matter. One word or metaphor can quickly define your concept and your uniqueness, and make your concept compelling. If you are selling something complex, simplify it with a metaphor. The generative power of words. The Gettysburg Address. The battlefield was not a testament to heroism. It was an ugly health hazard, a field of corpses that deeply concerned Pennsylvania's governor. Nor was that corpse-strewn field a monument to greatness. The North's general, Meade, had so bungled the battle, leaving Lee to regroup, that he submitted his resignation to President Lincoln. But Meade's opponent, Lee, had done no better, marching blindly into slaughter, a blunder so great that he submitted his resignation, too. The battlefield was Gettysburg, and no one aside from the people who teach American history or those who have read Gary Wills's Lincoln and Gettysburg sees Gettysburg as it was. Instead, they see Gettysburg as a symbol of heroism and a testament to people's commitment to their beliefs. The enormous gulf between the perception of Gettysburg and the reality can be explained in 276 words, the Gettysburg Address. With one deft speech, Lincoln changed almost everything, including our view of the Declaration of Independence and the view of millions of Americans living then and now. Lincoln's address vividly demonstrates the generative power of words, the power of words not simply to describe reality, but to create it. Our perception of Gettysburg has become the reality, just as our perceptions are changed by words every day. With 6 ingenious words, we're number 2. We try harder. Avis changed reality in the car rental business. With when it absolutely positively has to be there overnight, Federal Express swallowed up an enormous share of the overnight delivery business. With the personal computer, Apple Computer got computers into homes and accelerated a revolution in civilization. Later, with two words, desktop publishing, Apple created a concept that made the purchase of that home computer not merely tolerable to corporations, but desirable. Some words are wisps, others are warheads. The famous direct mail writer John Caples once changed one word in a NATA substituting fix for Epara and increased the response to the AD 20%. In the invisible world of services, where precious little can be shown and everything must be described, words are the ultimate weapons. Hollow and lazy words generate hollow and lazy responses, if any. Active, fresh, powerful words can do more than merely describe reality. Like Lincoln's words, words can change, shape, and even create reality. Remember Gettysburg, and the generative power of words. A robe is not a robe. Decades ago, Macy's department store was sitting on a pile of terry cloth robes. They were nice robes. Then a genius named Bernice Fitzgibbon grabbed them. "They aren't robes anymore," she said. "They're blotters. That's what the Europeans call them. That's how I'll sell them." Fitzgibbon's ads for blotters started a run on Macy's inventory. Sales skyrocketed. Macy's terry cloth robe was still just a terry cloth robe. Or was it? Sometimes, it's all in how you say it. Balderdash, of course you are committed to excellence. Of course you have a tradition of quality service. Of course you are responsive. And of course, you have become EA in 90s speak proactive and cost effective. But really, when a company pitches you that story, do you even try to catch it? Do you listen? Do you trust them? No, 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 you don't listen to cliche tilde copywriters. Your clients won't either. Improve the silence. Let's pick on accounting firms. They're the worst offenders. Call an accounting firm and request a brochure. When the brochure arrives, try to read it. Try to figure out quickly what makes that firm an excellent choice. You can't. And by the way, you won't try. You'll read the first three paragraphs, then quit. You know it's vague generalizations, not concrete examples. Puff. No proof, no evidence, no interest. Just words, especially adjectives. Communications like these tell your prospects one thing. They say you're willing to waste that person's time. No message can hurt you more. Every prospect hopes you will heed the old New England proverb, "Don't talk unless you can improve the silence." Get to the point or you will never get to the close. What's your point? Bob Boyle, one of successful presentations in Minneapolis, has built a useful book and a solid business around a presentation concept distilled into three words. What's your point? It's based on Bob's discovery that most presenters don't really know what their point is. Usually, their point is, "I want to sell you something," but to the listener, that point is obvious and meaningless. Most marketing communications fail for the same reason. They never tell you what their point is. Tell people in a single compelling sentence why they should buy from you instead of someone else. The vividness effect. Just as prospects put great value in recent information in making their buying decisions, they also are strongly influenced by vivid information. Vivid experiences can take over huge parts of a prospect's memory. No great salesman better illustrated this vividness effect than Ross Perot in the 1992 presidential campaign. To sell Perot to people, Perot used two primary weapons: vivid metaphors. 3 years later, people still remember silent sucking sound, and vivid pictures, his famous assortment of colorful charts and graphs. Long after they had forgotten the many dry details of the debates, people remembered Perot's vivid metaphors and charts. And so, despite his opponent's enormous head start in familiarity, Perot became a formidable competitor using the vividness effect as his primary marketing weapon. Perot's weapons were imaginative, but you need not be as spectacular to be vivid. Clear Lake Press in Wayska, Minnesota, recently created a vivid example of its exceptional service. A magazine client needed to print a subscription card to match its other printed materials. Clear Lake's president found an ink company that made a perfect ink match in one try, The client previously had tried 12 matches without luck. The ink company's district manager personally drove the test sample down from Minneapolis to Wayska and then drove it back a almost 200 miles round trip. Fred Betlack of Betlack Jewelers in Minneapolis uses the vividness effect and the true story of a diamond ring he created for another local jeweler. According to this story, captured in Betlack's brochure, Betlack's finished ring moved the recipient so deeply that she was still crying and unable to talk several hours after she first saw it. As further proof that vivid experiences become imprinted in people's memories, people to whom I mentioned Fred Betlack still ask me, "Is he the jeweler who made that woman cry?" You can find many ways to be vivid, and you should. In your words and pictures, make yourself vivid. Vivid words. For years, writing teachers have hounded their students to avoid cliché-tilde copyrights, and to find fresh ways to make their points instead. It's good marketing advice. 2. People respond to the new and novel and ignore the old, a characteristic that some anthropologists say is a human survival trait. Whenever something new entered a primitive person's environment, he had to study it to decide if it represented a risk. Whatever the explanation, people do respond to things that are new. That is why the very old word new still works in advertising. Sentences free of cliché-tilde copyrights and other tired words arouse and keep people's curiosity and attention. And fresh words sound sincere, like the real thoughts of the speaker rather than the meaningless recitation of something the speaker read or heard somewhere else many times before. Tired cliché-tilde copyrights and worn-out words bore people. As David Ogilvy once said, you cannot bore someone into buying your product. The value of publicity. There are 6 peaks in Europe higher than the Matterhorn. Name 1. Get ink. Advertising is publicity. Just when the first snows came to Minnesota in 1994, about the time of the 5th game of the World Series, as luck would have it, a prospect called me. He was desperate to work with me because of the mountain of publicity I had generated for another company in his industry. I was flattered. But while I do not want to correct the caller, he was wrong. Yes, I had helped generate some publicity for the company, a full-page trade magazine feature, a 3-paragraph blurb in a local newspaper business section, and a 3-paragraph mention in a national magazine. That was what the company aimed for, and we achieved our objectives. But it was not an avalanche. Why, then, did it seem like an avalanche to this prospect? Because we also ran 2 large ads in that same trade publication at the same time. In his vague memory, this prospect could not distinguish the ads from the articles. All he remembered was what seemed like a lot of publicity, and he wanted an avalanche. 2. The prospect demonstrated another principle of marketing. Advertising is publicity. Advertising is mention in the public forum from which people learn about and come to know the companies mentioned in the ads. If you want publicity, advertise. Advertising begets publicity. A public relations person contacted a local business magazine editor with a classic story, the story similar to the dreams of several million American executives trapped right now in downtown office towers. The story was of a longtime American resident who loved his native Greece and decided to lead some friends on a tour there. The friends raved. This made the man wonder, could he make a living doing just this? After weeks of wondering and months of trial and error, he started the business. Years later, that Bazinesa, the Greek travel agency Hellenic Adventuresa, is growing rapidly. But when the public relations person pitched this classic story, which proves a mother's advice, do what you love, the money will follow, the editor balked again and again. Why? The problem wasn't that the story had no appeal. It was that the story was just a story to the editor, because he had never heard of Hellenic Adventures. How could he be sure the company was real and viable, his trust in me notwithstanding? I'm not sure I can believe in that company, he said to himself. I've never heard of them. What would have simplified the public relations person's job? Advertising. If that editor had seen Hellenic Adventures' ads, the company had not yet started frequent advertising, he would have said, this is a real business, So this is a real story. Advertising, in short, would have led to publicity. The elements of a marketing effort are not separate elements. They work together, often in surprising ways. Advertising is publicity. Direct mail is advertising. Everything mingles and commingles, and virtually everything, done properly, will contribute. If you want more publicity, do more advertising. The essence of publicity. At this writing, no magazine or newspaper suffers from being too interesting. In a world deluged with communications, the task of creating an interesting weekly or monthly publication is daunting. With violent speed, editors are brought in and hurled out as increasingly strapped publications search for the formula. Whatever the formula may be, there is one thing it is not. No publication will get anywhere by running business advertisements thinly disguised as articles. Your typical press release, cleverly designed to get advertising without paying for it, will not work. In fact, the editors, who know their publication could use the advertising, will resent your effort. Transparent press releases also make their authors look naive and manipulative via an impression no one should make on any editor. The world is too small. What editors do want is to make their publications interesting. They want their readers to say love the article. So in efforts to publicize your service, never ask what makes our service so good. Instead, ask what makes our service interesting to that publication's readers. If you want editors to help you, help them. Give them something interesting. Give them a story. Inspiration from William F. Buckley. So all you need to do to generate a little publicity is to be a little interesting. Great. So you look around for a little while, and a little while longer, and longer. The next day, you sigh. I'm not sure there is anything interesting about our company. Look harder. John McPhee wrote a fascinating book about oranges. That's right, oranges. The TV journalist Harry Reasoner once narrated an enchanting mini-documentary about doors. Robert Persig wrote a bestseller on motorcycle maintenance. Hundreds of thousands of people who never rode a motorcycle read it avidly. There is no such thing as an uninteresting subject, someone once wrote. There is only an uninterested person. William F. Buckley gave another meaning to this when someone asked him about his interviews on Firing Line. What happens, the person asked Buckley, when you get a guest who is not interesting? That never happens, Buckley answered. If you look deeply enough, 99 out of 100 people are interesting and the 100th person is interesting because he isn't. Look harder. The Interesta and the Staria are there. Focus on buying, not selling. Some marketing experts recommend that in creating a direct mail program, you should devote half your time to creating the reply form. Most clients are surprised, if not shocked, when they hear this very revealing rule. The rule is revealing because it suggests that most marketers spend too much effort on the sale and too little on the buy. Think how often you have been virtually sold on something, but chose not to make the purchase because it was too hard to buy. The salesperson offered all sorts of options, for example, or made you worry about the value of extended warranty, or offered more complicated financing packages than you could not intelligently choose among. The product was too hard to buy. Now, think of your opposite experiences. Something appealed to you a little, not necessarily a lot, and the ease with which you could order, pay for, and receive the product ultimately led you to make the purchase. Good marketing must focus on the buy. How clear is your offer? Can the prospects sample the service, thereby reducing the risk? How clear is the price? How easy is it to buy? Make your service easy to buy. The most compelling selling message. What sells? The most compelling selling message you can deliver in any medium is not that you have something wonderful to sell. It is, I understand what you need. The selling message I have is about you. The message I understand is about the only person involved in the sale who really matters, the buyer. Find out what they want. Find out what they need. Find out who they are. It will take extra time, but it can make the sale. Don't sell your service, sell your prospect. What blank eyes mean? A salesperson has something to sell you. Blah, blah, blah. You hear, he continues, same thing, you hear the melody, but not the lyrics. Eventually, you graciously thank him and promise you will get back to him. Which, of course, you don't. You know why his pitch failed, because the person did not talk about you. His entire pitch was about him and what he had, not about you and what you need. It was all about him, but what you cared about was you. Do you know why your pitches fail? 2. Talk about him, not about you. Presenting's first rule, imitate Dick. For 14 months, I enjoyed the strange and wonderful experience of working with Dick Wilson. Everyone should be so lucky. Dick is a genius at presenting. To appreciate his genius, let me set the stage. It is the wood-paneled living room in the historic Pillsbury Mansion. Top executives from Musicland have come to Carmichael Lynch Advertising to hear the agency's pitch. Dick, who will lead the creative presentation, is wearing a coat and tie, but still looks like he has just finished mowing the lawn. After the writer and art director have shown their ideas for Musicland's new TV commercials, Dick rises to summarize. His summary should take 5 minutes. It takes 40. Dick emotes, rambles, enthuses. He swerves off on tangents from which even the Musicland execs try to rescue him. The clients are lost. Dick may be lost, and this is a huge Buddha. We never take our eyes off him. It is not because of what Dick says, it is because of what he feels. Dick cares. He believes in what he is saying, and he cares about doing wonderful commercials that will help Musicland sell millions of records. And in an industry known for slickness, Dick is just Dick. Nothing is planned. How could such a presentation be planned? No clever references to tidbits he has learned about each Musicland executive. No fascinating creative type tie, nah affectations, nah attitude, yeah, nothing the client might have expected from an award-winning creative director. Dick won this and 4 other major presentations in succession, the best winning record in Twin Cities advertising, for 4 reasons. He shattered the stereotype. He never pretended. He risked showing his true self. And he cared passionately and showed clients how much he cared. You should have seen him. You should copy him. Mission statements. Like movies, books, TV shows, and everything else, there are many bad mission statements. This does not mean that mission statements are inherently bad or that drafting one is foolish. A good one has value, if only to show employees the pot of gold at the rainbow's end. But mission statements do not belong in your marketing communications. Mission statements tell people where you are going, your strategic goal, and good companies, like good generals, never alert their competitors to where they are going. What's more, a good mission statement describes the future, not the present, and prospects want to know who you are right now. Write a mission statement, but keep it private. What a mission statement must be and must have. Make your mission statement specific. Tell employees and stakeholders exactly where to go. If you say, "We're going to San Francisco," people know where to head and can chart their progress. If you say, "We're going west," people may think they've achieved the goal 3 miles after they start. Employees want those directions. Nothing confuses employees more and inspires them less than vague marching orders and no roadmap. So follow every mission statement with a concrete statement of measurable objectives. Give people a clear target so they can see how achieving those immediate objectives will help them achieve the mission. Draw a clear map. And after every mission statement, add an objective statement. When to can a mission statement? The test of a mission statement is simple. A mission statement must cause change. It must change how people in your company act. 3 weeks after you reveal your mission statement to everyone, ask 5 employees, "Have you done anything differently in the last 3 weeks because of what the mission statement says? And are you likely to change anything that you do in the next 3 weeks?" If you get 10 no's, throw out your mission statement. If your mission statement isn't producing, fire it. What really sells? In the factories we make perfume, Revlon founder Charles Revson once said, but in the stores we sell hope. So do we all. Everywhere, people are buying happiness, or the hope of it. Happiness is so important in our country that its pursuit is considered an inalienable right, together with the right to life itself in our Declaration of Independence. People want to smile, and will pay handsomely for it. Sit in on a group of magazine editors reviewing the best-selling covers of the year. The bestsellers are almost always happier and more hopeful. Sit in on a review of a test of different direct mail letters for the same service. The most upbeat letter almost always wins. This is why one noted direct mail copywriter advises writers, never write when you are worried. My wife once recommended a typically set Swedish film to a co-worker. Her co-worker said, forget it. If I want to be unhappy, I can just open my checkbook. Samsonite once created a brilliant, award-winning ad showing its luggage being dropped out of an airplane. The luggage survived the fall, an incredible reminder of its durability. Unfortunately, the commercial also reminded people of airplane crashes. Sales actually dropped, too. Bumper stickers now urge people to commit random acts of kindness. Make people smile, the stickers urge. We want to smile more. Read through everything you send to clients and prospects. How does it feel? Does it sell happiness, or the hope of it? Above all, sell hope. Holding on to what you've got. Nurturing and keeping clients. Relationship accounting. Huge account shifts agencies, reads the monthly headline in Advertising Age, and in the second paragraph you often find a revealing quote. The jilted agency president says he is shocked. We were doing excellent work at Smith Smith. The client told us she was happy. This is a total surprise. The president's surprise is genuine, and so is his problem. His problem is rooted in the nature of service relationships. Unless a service provider like Smith Smith pays careful attention, it always operates at a deficit. Without knowing it, service providers always owe their clients. This debt dates from the first day, when Smith Smith wins the account. Winning implies that Smith Smith's people feel they have earned the business. But as Theodore Levitt has convincingly argued, the client sees it differently. Smith Smith has not earned the business, it merely has earned the right to earn the business. The client has assumed all the risk, and from that, feels it has done Smith Smith a favor. The client has bought something that the agency has not yet delivered. When that something comes, it could be awful, too expensive, or both. So Smith Smith already is operating at a deficit. It owes the client one. Then Smith Smith begins delivering services, a storyboard for a TV spot, for example, along with a bill. The client is not sure what it has received or how good it is, just as accountants and lawyers clients do not know if they have received a good product for a fair price. The client only knows that it owes a lot for something of uncertain value that has not yet produced a return. The deficit now is two. Smith Smith soon increases its deficit again. People make mistakes, and Jim at Smith Smith makes one. He fails to call the client back as promptly as the receptionist promised. Whoever made the mistake, either Jim, Jim's receptionist, or the client, by mishearing a Smith Smith's deficit reaches three. Now and then, Smith Smith's president makes a gesture to the client. He sends Godiva chocolates at Christmas, for example. But the president cannot easily overcome the large deficit, because those inevitable mistakes happen faster than the president can mail chocolates. Most clients will overlook these mistakes if Smith & Smith has a surplus in its relationship account. But like most service providers, Smith Smith has a deficit. So the mistakes go in the debit column. No one at Smith Smith realizes how far they are in debt. Service providers always are the last to know, in part because few people like conflict. So clients often bury grievances rather than air them. Service providers think that the silence is golden. They think the lack of complaints means the relationship is going well. But it is growing worse. This relationship deficit exists in the parties' other significant relationships, their marriages. In both relationships, debts grow without either side knowing. Then one day a frustrated spouse or a frustrated client announces he has had enough. The other spouse and the Smith president are shocked. Neither person understands the unique accounting in relationships. Watch your relationship balance sheet, assume it is worse than it appears, and fix it. The day after, why getting the business can be the first step in losing it. You can generate significant sales for a service simply by promising miracles. After doing that, you have a new client who can't wait for the magic you promised. In short, you have the client from hell. Even if you do a very good job, you have a disappointed client. Your client wasn't expecting a very good job, she was expecting a great job you promised. This phenomenon is the bane of the collections agency industry, and explains why that industry is all churn, a constant business of getting new clients to replace those who are fleeing. The salespeople deliver passionate sales pitches, the clients sign up, the salespeople pocket their commissions, and the client thinks those blankety-blank deadbeats will finally pay. But those blankety-blanks still don't pay. Only about 21% do pay. Do collections agency prospects ever hear that even a good agency will collect less than 30% of the debts outstanding? Number. So 79% of their prospects end up disappointed and leave for another agency. If you make a client think you will do better than you can do, the client will end up disappointed. Even worse, she will decide that you misled her, or lied. It isn't worth getting that business. A disappointed person who thinks you are a liar will usually tell three other people. Suddenly, one great sale has become four big problems. Don't raise expectations you cannot meet. Expectations, satisfaction, and the perils of hype. What dissatisfies a client? It is not bad service in some absolute sense of bad. You send a letter to New York that takes 3 days. Is that bad delivery? Well, it is terrible delivery for an overnight service and hideous delivery for a fax, but it is acceptable delivery for a letter. It is the level of service you have learned to expect, so you're satisfied. A customer's satisfaction is the gap between what the customer expects and what she gets. Service below her expectations makes her dissatisfied, and the greater the gap, the greater her dissatisfaction. This means that one of a marketer's most suicidal marketing weapons is hype. Few marketers can resist using hyperbole to boost sales. But does it work for the long term? Ask IBM. In 1983, IBM introduced its PC Junior with an uncharacteristic flood of hype. Americans got Charlie Chaplin into believing that this new PC would be the IBM of personal computers. That raised people's expectations enough. The added hot air from what was typically such a modest company inflated expectations even more. The PC Junior could never meet those expectations. People who tried the PC Junior were dissatisfied, because it fell below the enormous expectations that IBM's hype had created. Because of that debacle, IBM lost a chunk of its customer franchise. If IBM had tried to follow the PC Junior with a product that really was revolutionary, few would have believed it. IBM had lost the credibility needed to make that claim. It was 7 years before IBM earned its way back in, and then only with an exceptional product, the PS1. It could just as easily happen to you. To manage satisfaction, you must carefully manage your customers' expectations. Your patrons are saints. She has come to you. She has paid for expensive entry-tilde copyrights, your favorite CDs, and part of your kids' upcoming college tuitions. She has tolerated your mistakes, more than you know. She has risked her money, her reputation, her peace of mind, and most of her neck. She may even have risked her entire business. She has smiled through the worst, laughed through the best, and said nice things about you to other people. And so now you ask, should I call her? Should I feel any debt? Should I care about her? Should I bother to tell her? And if I do tell her, how often should I tell her? There is no such thing as too often, too grateful, too warm, or too appreciative. After all, she has been through a more than you know. You cannot thank your client too much. And you probably are not doing it enough. Your parents were right. Say thank you often. Thanks. We tell someone we cannot thank them enough. We're right, we can't keep thinking. Few things feel more gratifying than gratitude, and few services express their gratitude as much as they should. How many notes of thanks did you send last year? A suggestion: send twice as many this year. Keep thinking. Where have you gone? Emily Post. We all get too little thanks, and we yearn for more. The rarer thanks become, and they do seem rarer the more we value the thanks we get. A huge national charity asks a working mother to canvass her block to raise funds. Carrying her 6-month-old son as she walks, she raises $160, 60% more than last year's captain. In return for those 3 evenings and her own $30 contribution, she never hears from the charity again. 3 weeks later, a professional association invites a man to Keene Audit's one-day seminar. He says he can make it only by cutting 1 day short of vacation to visit his mother and sister. The association begs, and the speaker relents. Returning from his West Coast vacation, the speaker gets stranded in Denver. He arrives in Minneapolis just in time to fuzzbust his way to the conference. He catches his breath and delivers his speech. The audience responds very enthusiastically. The seminar hosts barely respond. They mail a 4-sentence form letter to all 13 speakers. 5 weeks later, a famous art institution asks a prominent professional to donate an evening to consult the institute. She does, rushing from dinner to arrive early. A week later, she, like her 3 fellow contributors, receives a 2-paragraph form letter. With it is a certificate for 20% off any art shop purchase exceeding $50. In short, the institute thanks the woman for her entire evening away from her family and for $425 worth of professional advice by agreeing to make a slightly smaller profit on her next significant purchase. How would you feel about those services? Would you contribute to their success? Would you promote and patronize them? Would you recommend them? And these experiences also make me wonder, did these services know the impression they were making and the harm they were causing? Have we forgotten to say thank you? Have you forgotten? Do you thank people enough? Are you sure? Poised for a fall. Brace yourself. A typical service client cannot tell when the service is performed well. He cannot tell if the motivational speaker really motivated his salespeople, if the tailor made the perfect alterations to make the suit most flattering, or if the lawyer won emotion that another lawyer would have lost. But a typical client is very good at seeing that the speech fell flat, that the pant legs are 1/4 too long, and that the court denied his attorney's motion. In short, few clients know how good they have it, but all of them know how bad. And so, the central fact of service marketing is this frustrating one. It is much easier to fail in a service than to succeed. To make matters worse, most service relationships are not deeply cultivated. A few meetings here, a couple of lunches there. Add up those hours, and they rarely equal 2 dates. Unfortunately, trust takes time and more than 2 dates worth. And so service failures, which are much more obvious than successes, erode the client's already weak trust at the heart of the relationship. Given that failures are obvious but most successes are invisible, what must you do? Advertise your successes. Show your client what you have done. If you beat the deadline by 2 days, a good idea, make sure the client knows. If you came under the estimate by 7%, an even better idea, make sure the client knows. If you are especially proud of something you did, make sure the client knows. Don't expect the client to see how hard you have worked, how much you have cared, and how well you have performed. So often, the client is the last to know. Make sure the client knows. Satisfaction and services. How do you satisfy a service customer? With surprising difficulty, as you will realize when you compare it to your own experiences with buying products. You decide to buy a car, for example. Our world being arranged as it is around the automobile, you need a car. If you are typical, you also desire a car and may even covet a particular one. The leather seats, the special trim packages, the 6 coats of paint, and the messages that car conveys. When you buy that car, You are satisfied the second you pull out of the dealership. The car is just what you wanted. After you buy a product, it constantly reinforces your satisfaction. You golf, for example. You covet and buy a Titleist Tour 100 Ballot a golf ball. Each time you wash and wipe off the ball, the white-on-white finish that attracted and satisfied you from the beginning reminds you what a smart purchase you made and how satisfied you are. Each time you strike the ball well, the ball's high arc through the air and soft landing on the distant green reminds you again. Your Tour 100 ball continually satisfies you just as the car, a flattering sweater, or that big screen TV satisfies you constantly by its presence. Seeing is believing. And what you see makes you feel satisfied. Now, the contrast, you decide you might need a service. Your roof leaks or your tooth aches, for example. You rarely desire a particular service, and almost never covet one. In fact, you regard many services as necessary evil. Said the lawyer you must hire to resolve a dispute, the accountant you must retain because you cannot deal with complicated books, the insurance you must own should disaster strike. In most cases, you are less eager and enthusiastic and less satisfied when you choose a service. Unlike products that you buy, the services you use come, then go. They do not stick around to remind you of your satisfaction and to encourage you to purchase them again. The lawn the neighbor boy mows nicely one day needs mowing again just days later. The tooth the dentist filled no longer aches. But nothing about the filled tooth satisfies you or reminds you of the good service you received. Your much-needed insurance policy is just sitting in a file somewhere, doing nothing at all. You no longer can see the few visible reminders of these services that you received. Your satisfaction with them is primarily a memory. So the typical service deliverer like you is not present to make its clients conscious of the benefits that the service still is providing. The pipes that are now draining properly, the insurance coverage that provides much-needed disability coverage for the sole proprietor, the contract addendum that retains for the author valuable rights for his book. The homeowner with the fixed pipes was satisfied for a couple days, then forgot about it. The business proprietor and the author one day may be very satisfied, but for now, they are not even aware of the service. The question of satisfaction does not even arise. Given these significant differences between typical product and service buyers and their satisfaction, what should the service marketer do to create a satisfied client? Stay present. Advertising and publicity reminds clients and former clients of the satisfying service that you once provided, and assures them that you still are around, viable, and successful. Create a feeling of satisfaction by showing the client how you are satisfying others. Communicate your successes, new clients, new successes, new awards, new recognition, new testimonials, growth in staff and revenues. A product continually reminds its buyers that it is good. With appropriate modesty, you must, too. Out of sight is out of mind. Quick fixes. Manage the tiny things. I recently interviewed three people to subcontract for a client's project. I already had decided that each person was skilled enough. That's why I called each one. Choosing the best candidate was easy. I hired the person who wrote back after the interviews first. So often, and more often than we imagine, that is the difference in a sale. Not superior knowledge. Not superior talent or years of experience. Just something tiny. Like a short thoughtful letter. Sweat the smallest stuff. One ring. Fallon McElligott sells very creative advertising. That means that it sells its creative people. And creative people are difficult. Egos. They'll be done whenever. And so what if it costs lots of money? That's the stereotype. Anyway, several summers ago, I decided that my 3-on-3 basketball team really needed Jamie Barrett, a 6A-squared 5A-cubed forward, copywriter at Fallon McElligott. So during my recruiting campaign, and later during our season, I often called Jamie at work. I would reach Fallon's receptionist in one ring, and Jamie one ring and a split second later. It could be the world's fastest phone system. The first three times I tapped into it I wasn't ready to talk. I didn't expect Jamie to answer so suddenly. Those calls left an amazing impression. Those 3 seconds and three different phone calls convinced me that Fallon really delivered service, that Fallon made you feel respected and wanted, which is critical for a service. Thos told me that Fallon wasn't an undisciplined, arrogant, screw service. It's beneath a sponge after all. Amazing. 3 seconds. Now I am telling the world. People in a dozen cities will read this and decide that Fallon delivers great service and very creative advertising. Service like that is worth whatever it costs. Your business starts with the first call. How good is yours? Speed. Life is lickety-split. Dayton Hudson Corporation's chairman rallies employees with a line from Future Shock. Speed is life. Comedian Stephen Wright captured the current pace of life when he deadpanned about his microwave fireplace. You can spend an evening in front of it in only 8 minutes. Too many people. The world seems driven out of whack with all this speed. We fax when we could mail. We rush out of habit. It seems we really do want microwave fireplaces. There is no logic to all this speed. There also is no point in arguing speed is where the world is going. Be fast. Then get faster. Say PM. Deliver AM. The first time you have something to deliver for a client, try this. Say you'll have it to him at 1 p.m., then deliver it at 11 a.m. Do it the next time, too. Now you have money in the bank. You may need it. And you'll be glad you had it. Say p.m. Deliver a.m. Note to myself. Something suddenly struck me. I grabbed a pen and jotted on a yellow post-it note the first value of my business. Make every client very happy every day. Something from a self-help book. Corny and obvious. It almost embarrasses me, but it does something else. It works. It changes how I talk, how I sound, like I am smiling, what I say, and how well I listen. It reminds me how lucky I am to have this person place so much faith in me. Now, how do I talk, sound, and listen when the note gets buried under my other papers? Different and honest. So do something corny. Put that note by your phone. Shoot the message, not the messenger. The fastest way to improve your sales force. In 15 seconds, Clifford could talk your children into attending Yale. Judy could quiet an entire room with her passionate defense of her position on abortion. Fred has convinced 11 of his friends to buy shad wrap fishing lures. Then I asked the brokerage company executive about these 3 people, her fellow partners. Are they pretty good at selling? Oh, they're okay. Are they selling effectively now? Not really. Not nearly as well as we'd like. What's the problem? With few exceptions, the problem is not the sales force. Like most people, Clifford, Judy, and Fred are extremely adept at selling things they believe in. This company's selling problem is actually a marketing problem. The company has failed to create or identify the distinction that makes a selling message powerful, and that makes the salespeople true believers. Sent off to pitch prospects, Clifford, Judy, and Fred start from weakness. Their message sounds fuzzy. They don't sound truly convinced and confident. It's no wonder. The key to any effective presentation is having a clear point of view. If you have one you believe in, you are almost certain to be effective in presenting it. Does your sales force have that clear point of view? A few people may. But if your firm has not created or clearly identified its distinction, and the benefits of that distinction, to people who use the service, most people will not present your case effectively for one simple reason: you haven't developed that case. To fix your messengers, fix your message. Personal investment. Say risk to business people, and they hear money. Sometimes, they're right. But many of the risks that people fail to take and the rewards they miss because of it cost nothing. These risks are personal. Consider the director of an exceptional service. The service is excellent, but the sales are merely good. Why? Because the director refuses to take the personal risks involved in personally selling his product. A big convention of prospects comes to town, afraid to risk himself among strangers. The director gets sick on the day of the convention. On another occasion, someone mentions a good prospect for the director in the same town. The director never calls the prospect. Gail Sheehy illuminated the rewards of risk-taking in her book Pathfinders. Sheehy began her research looking for the secrets of truly contented people. She wondered what made these people feel such a sense of well-being. Sheehy learned that people of high well-being shared just a few traits, and this was one. They all had taken an enormous risk. Selling a service involves personal risks. You can look too pushy. You can be rejected. No, you will be rejected. People won't return your calls. You run the risk of feeling bad when you go home at night. But the rewards of all those efforts will make you wonder, why didn't I do that in the first place? Taking risks doesn't always mean risking your money. Sometimes, it just means risking yourself. Risk yourself. The collision principle. Kurt Vonnegut, Jr.'s God Bless You, Mr. Rosewater contains some excellent advice for every marketer. Mr. Rosewater, Sr., recognizing that his son, Elliot, had neither the brains nor the talent to become hugely successful, gave Elliot the best advice under the circumstances. Elliot, someday a large sum of money will change hands. Make sure you are in the middle of it. Mr. Rosewater's advice inspired me when a gifted graphic designer asked my advice on her new career. I said, just get out there, get an opportunity's way, let it hit you. It applies to every service marketer. For all the talk about improving service quality, positioning, research, targeted direct mail, for all the art and science of marketing and much of growing a business is where you happen to sit on a flight to New York one afternoon. People don't want to spend days making decisions. They have little time, and books like Overworked American suggest that they have less time every year. People meet you, they like you, pretty soon they hire you. Some people propose on their first date. After all, many people in business move even faster. Get out there, almost anywhere. Let opportunity hit you. Summing up, you outline a business problem to a group. Finance says it's a resource problem. Human resources says it's a people problem. Research says it's an information problem. And marketing says there's no problema, just double the marketing budget. But more and better marketing is not the answer to every business question. For all its marketing brilliance, for example, McDonald's probably would have fallen into bankruptcy without its brilliant real estate strategy, the strategy that today accounts for most of the company's revenues and $8.8 billion of its book value. For all the brilliant campaigns that established its brand in overnight delivery, Federal Express never would have flown without Fred Smith's skillful negotiating and lobbying in Washington, and without the company's mastery of systems and logistics. Federal Express's clever campaigns probably would have killed the company. Millions of people attracted by the ads would have discovered that the service absolutely positively did not work. They would have told their friends, and that would have destroyed the company's reputation. To succeed spectacularly in a service business, you must get all your ducks in a row. Marketing is just one duck, but it is one very big duck. Take the case of American Express. In 1972, you could herd American Express's entire marketing department into a bus shelter of just 15 people with a budget of $4 million. Today, few people can count all the employees in the department, and the ad budget alone exceeds $210 million. And that money has been very well spent. Ogilvy Mathers, Do You Know Me? And Don't Leave Home Without It campaigns brilliantly focused and communicated the company's position and status and propelled the company to a place that ordinary merchandising never would have taken it. This book also devotes 15 pages to the importance of service brands. 5 years ago, this book would not have mentioned them, because I was deeply influenced by all the rumors about the decline of brands. Then I watched dozens of branded services beat superior services. for no apparent reason other than their brand. We hear so much about service quality today, but much of service quality is simply a here's that word again invisible to the client. And for marketing purposes, if for the purpose of attracting and keeping buzziness, a service is only what prospects and clients perceive it to be. So get better reality. Improve your service quality, but never forget that the prospect and client must perceive that quality. When we are clients of a hotel, for example, we know our room has been spotlessly cleaned. We do not hold that perception because the room actually is spotless. We believe that the room is spotless because, as Theodore Levitt perceptively has pointed out, the hotel has wrapped each glass tightly in paper and covered the toilet seat with a sanitized wrap. We do not see the quality. We see these symbols of quality that say clean room. It is not the hotel's service quality that wins us. It is the hotel's merchandising of its quality. Our methods for choosing a service are often wild and seemingly arbitrary, anything but intelligent. Cost-benefit-oriented behavior. This suggests that you cannot expect to seize a market just by creating a provably superior service with a demonstrably higher benefit-to-cost ratio. The success of American Express suggests something much different. Services are human. Their successes depend on the relationships of people. People are humana frustrating, unpredictable, temperamental, often irrational, and occasionally half mad. But you can spot some patterns in people. The more you can see the patterns and better understand people, the more you will succeed. And this book was written with the hope that it will help you do just that. Recommended reading for service marketers. Because many of marketing's greatest battles are not waged in the market, but in the minds of prospects, understanding how people think helps you understand how to market and sell. You see that emphasis throughout this book. My interest in thinking was inspired by watching people in two different companies stumble through marketing planning. The thinking I saw proved that synergy is a myth. Two heads may be better than one, but 12 heads are worse. I then read Peter Senge's The Fifth Discipline to help me understand systems thinking. I recommend the book, even though it is tough waiting. I also recommend Kakadizes's Corporate Life Cycles. It can help you understand how people tend to think at different stages of a company's life. There are thousands of books on the human mind and memory, but even my strong performance in Psychology 101 does not qualify me to choose among them. I benefited from Decision Traps by J. Edward Russo and Paul J. H. Schoemaker, influenced by Robert Cialdini, and How We Know What Isn't So by Thomas Jelavich. None of these books require an advanced degree in psychology, and all three remind me that in so many things in life, logic has nothing to do with it. For years, I worked with art directors on ads, trusting our intuitions. We thought our intuitions about people were enough. They weren't. And we all misuse the word intuition. We imply that intuitions are instinctive, perhaps even extrasensory. But my intuitions about O.J. Simpson's guilt or innocence, for example, reflect my previous experiences with alleged wife batterers, their reliability of legal evidence, and with the man himself with a large volume of information. My intuitions, like everyone else's, are based on information and experience. They are based on data. The more and better information we have about people, including about how people think and make decisions, the better our intuitions will be. Away from the psychology section, you can find several books about the distinctive requirements for marketing a service. Jan Carlzon introduces moments of truth, a notion that is similar to my discussion of points of contact. Ronald Zimk's The Service Edge lists hundreds of examples of excellent service and strongly recommends listening and surveying. Tom Peters's books are filled with examples and have influenced most people's thoughts about service. Whenever someone thinks of getting close to the customer, for example, those are Peters's four words vibrating in their head. Regis McKenna's The Regis Touch and Paul Hawkins' Growing a Business include very good discussions about the importance of relationships in marketing. In the service marketing section, however, The shelves are almost empty. You will find books with titles like Marketing Your Services. Most of them are books for consultants and sole proprietors. However, with advice like get published in magazines, give speeches, join the local chamber of commerce. This is good advice, to be sure, but people to whom it is new and valuable information probably should not enter business. Perhaps the most widely distributed book on service marketing is Marketing Services, by Leonard Berry and A. Parajuraman. The book's strength is in the first half, which puts the emphasis in service marketing where the emphasis belongs, getting the service right, on communicating. I recommend Strunk and White's The Elements of Style and Williams and Sir's On Writing Well. I also recommend David Ogilvy's Confessions of an Advertising Man, a book so interesting that my mother read it 35 years ago just for fun. But nothing I can recommend will help you create names as ingenious as NameLab, themes as effective as We're Number Two, We Try Harder, or concepts as clever as negotiable certificates of deposit. I believe imagination is the greatest possible asset in marketing, in part because imagination is rare and, in all likelihood, unteachable. On positioning, Rise and Trout's positioning is a classic. A bearable flaw of the book and no book can cover everything is that the authors stress how the human mind works, yet ignore volumes of research on the influence of recency and vividness on the mind. Rise and Trout suggests that positioning is not heavily dependent on the words and images used. They seem to suggest that good positioning statements make strong headlines and theme lines. Cynics might suggest that Rise and Trout de-emphasized words and images and downsized the importance of creativity because their ad agency's creative product was weak. Maybe so. It is wise to read their book, a very good book, with that in mind. On presenting, I recommend Bob Boylan's What's Your Point? And Anything by Ron Hoff. Most of all, however, I recommend watching a presentation by my former boss, Dick Wilson. Some things cannot be explained, they must be seen. A Dick Wilson presentation is one of them. On marketing generally, and service marketing particularly, I save my strongest recommendation for last, Theodore Levitt's The Marketing Imagination, particularly chapters 5 and 6. Levitt strongly influenced my sections on relationship deficits and the importance of visibles. Nothing beats experience, of course, but reading books about others' experiences comes in a competent second. The risk in learning only from personal experience is that too often, we draw conclusions from too little data, we learn too much from too little. We also tend to credit our company's successes to everything that went into them, the classic fallacy post hoc ergo propter hoc, it happened after the fact therefore it happened because of that fact. And so we keep repeating things that hurt our business. In Decision Traps, Russo and Schumacher tell the amusing story of the man who explains how he won the huge Spanish lottery. The man chose a number ending in 48. He said he knew the winning number would end in 48 because for 7 days before he picked the number, he woke up thinking of the number 7. And 7 times 7 is 48, he said. So of course, I picked 48. All people act like the Spanish lottery winner at times. We mislead ourselves. We link our successes and failures to things that barely influence the outcome. In marketing, for example, we sometimes decide that a tactic has failed only because we do not see the impact when we expected it. Years later, we often discover that the tactic worked perfectly, just slowly, and even unpredictably. So my recommendation to anyone marketing in this new economy is to learn all you can from your experiences and from the experiences of others. These books help. A Failed Guide.